as oil and gas revenues decant $8.6 billion into Uganda's GDP, oil production from Lake Albert Basin starts in 2025. On this economic and development journey, China remains a great partner and the Uganda-China relationship has never been this vibrant.
In 2019, China-Uganda relationship was elevated to comprehensive cooperative relationship with the strategic guidance by the leaders of the two countries. Our relationship have enjoyed good momentum, and as a matter of fact, it has reached the best time in history.
Under the comprehensive cooperation partnership with China, we've been able to benefit from concessional financing. We've borrowed concessionally from the government of the People's Republic of China, and we've invested in our key infrastructure projects. In oil and gas, through the China National Offshore Oil Corporation, CNOOC, we've been able to pull in about $5 billion just through the China National Offshore Oil Corporation. In addition to CNOOC's investment, we have seen more investment in the crude oil pipeline, where we are having Chinese-based companies participating.
The China National Offshore Oil Corporation, CNOOC, is working with a number of African firms to see Uganda realize her dream. It is also overseeing the creation of a pipeline from the oil fields in Uganda to Tanzania's Indian Ocean port of Tanga. CNOOC remains the largest producer of offshore crude oil and natural gas in China and one of the largest independent oil and gas exploration and production companies in the world. The company has its footprint in the world's most significant basins like Asia, Africa, America, Europe, and in the Middle East.
It's a corporate citizen that has demonstrated itself with the capacity and two, with the corporate values to be able to participate in this sector. And where we are, it's not only about the commercial interests, it's also about the social responsibility.
Kingfisher is an offshore site but accessed on the shore, meaning the oil well is under the water table.
An offshore field, basically, it's under the lake basin. The deepest end of that lake is not even 60 meters. It's offshore but accessed onshore. You have to drill it, you have to access it via land, but going under the lake, and you get to the reservoir, which is far below the lake basin. Over 3,000 meters underneath the lake basin.
At Kingfisher, a 60.5-meter tall LR8001 rig significantly stands. The modern drilling rig runs day and night with barely any noise. The rig was set up and is managed by the China National Offshore Company, CNOOC.
What we see behind us is a drilling rig, and it is what we're using in our development phase to drill wells, which is where we'll be producing our oil from. So the rig behind me is called the LR8001. Or 801, and it is capable of drilling up to 8,000 meters into the subsurface, which is where our oil resources, our petroleum resources, are found.
The four oil pads, oil pad 1, 2, 3, and 4, will feed into the central processing facility.
All the well pads are quite progressed. They are completed, and we have had the rig at well pad 2, where it started from after spudding. Drilled the wells, it went to well pad 3, and right now it is at well pad 1, and well pad 4 is under preparations. The civil works are going on to prepare it also to receive the rig.
The CPF is where the extracted fluid from all the four oil pads will be collected through the infield pipes.
Kingfisher will be processed, it's about 40,000 barrels per day. Now what happens is that when crude oil is produced from the ground, it comes with a certain impurity. All the production from all the fields will be gathered and taken through the central processing facility.
So all the separation is done from here, and after we have separated and we have the crude stabilized, then it goes into what we call the feeder pipeline, which starts right from the CPF here terminating through the escarpment for another 46 kilometers up to the delivery point at Kabale, where there is going to be a refinery. And that's where the upstream project stops.
The project is expected to increase jobs in the minerals and values chain by 63% from 1.6 million in 2017-2018 financial year to 2.6 million in the 2024-2025 financial year. Today, CINOC employs over 80% Ugandans. This is to ensure continuity and mentorship of Ugandans so that they can support the government on other projects when new discoveries are done.
I've been able to understand much more about the oil and gas industry. I've had the opportunity to work as a drilling engineer. We are working with different service companies, different operations, and so that experience has had a lot of learning, a lot of career growth, and participate beneficially and be able to go further. Today I'm an engineer, and perhaps tomorrow I'll be a leader within the Uganda oil industry.
We have a mentorship program where they are assigned to the experts who are training them to ensure that there is knowledge transfer.
A culture that CINOC Uganda Limited has tried to endorse. And so I've found good mentorship with my supervisors that have been able to teach me. I am progressing in the capacity to be able to handle future prospects. So far, this would be my second year in the industry. And I currently work with supervisors that have done up to 20 years. We have sayings in the field such as, the subsurface is always surprising, the industry is always changing, equipment evolving, but I can confidently say that we are progressing and Uganda has a definite, sure future with the generation that has been given an opportunity to partake of these operations.
The host community depended on stream and lake water that exposed them to waterborne diseases like cholera.
In fact, everybody here was living on his or her own because we had a lot of diseases, waterborne diseases. We had access to good water. We could use the lake. And of course, you know the characteristics of fishermen. Cholera was very rampant in this area and it killed a lot of people here.
Today, my being here, it is very important to me because my community is free from any waterborne diseases. And we are blessed to have CINOC in Uganda. I studied a bachelor's degree in accounting and finance. So when I came to this place, there was no way to get what to do. I was a fisherman and he also had a small saloon. CINOC picked me from down level there, not even knowing my education background. Right now my profession has been changed from fisherman to water treatment engineer.
The project has put in place a gravity solar-powered water point connecting to over 85 taps with clean and safe running water for the community.
I was taught how to purify the water from the intake tank to the last treatment point where we introduce sodium hypochloride.
The project has also provided a road network, famously known as the Snake Road, given its design running down the escarpment. Previously, many people lost lives as a result of poor connectivity and, of course, facilities. Pregnant women and the sick had a tough time being moved up the escarpment for treatment. Bottled water costs 1,000 shillings or less, but it used to go for 3,000 shillings and above because of the cost of transport.
Tamaka Road was worked on and we are now accessing it. That is really a good achievement. We are appreciating to CINOC. You know, we used to suffer a lot. We could carry our women from here up to Changwali on back when actually they are going to deliver. Something like 15 kilometers from here to Changwali. That's where we could get a means of transport moving us ahead in Hoima and Kampala.
Ngamba mwevale mkatukolero mburungi wesi noka mkatukolero gudoro tukatuli kubimuno timanyiro muli muntu na arwara nimamuhimba kuhimba mbelega nimamuhimba mbelega nimamuhimba nimamtuara tusozi ubukote inu mulingu bara mtuara mutoka tero baito basinoko vaizire bakatuletero singe muno nyomba simira kimu kikuma kikumino baba vaizire bale sene mitingi yao.
She falls sick in the other village, you have to call members from here to go and support, because it was a very big task. You can imagine somebody weighing 90 kilograms lifting our him to the escarpment here. Very, very, very tedious.
The escarpment road could be about 6+ kilometers. And before its establishment, the communities were using a path to come up and down the escarpment. For that communication, in terms of transportation, was very, very, very difficult. Because accessing here either goods and services, people had to move them. You can imagine if you needed construction materials, the only way to get them here was through carrying them in tons to come down the escarpment. Or the other alternative, the communities would go to Butiaba in Bulisa, load them on the boats, or go to Ntoroko, further south here, which is about maybe 50 kilometers away from here, to put them on the boats to bring them here.
The East African Pipeline will be 1,443 kilometers long from Kabale in Hoima District, southwestern Uganda, to Tanga Port in Tanzania. It will be built with a capacity to transport 2,016 barrels of crude oil per day. Each barrel is about 159 liters. The project will have a great impact on the export and import substituting, especially when the refinery starts running.
When the refinery receives crude, it refines it into products that we consume on a daily basis. So it will produce liquefied petroleum gas, it will produce petrol, it will produce diesel, jet fuel. But at the bottom of the barrel, there are certain products that are not for our consumption straight away. And these products become feedstock for petrochemical industries, feedstock for fertilizer industries, and so we'll be able to produce all the petrochemical products that we import as a country. And what is important to us is that these products that we import, that we spend so much money on, will be produced here, and so that is import substitution. It supports our balance of trade, supports our balance of payment, it creates value chain employment. And so the factor of value that is created by just creating more products in terms of employment, in terms of taxes, in terms of know-how, supply chain, is what we're excited about.
Our practical cooperation has brought with good results. And our cooperations on the international arena has been very active. We're working together to safeguard the common interests of the global south as well as the developing countries. And we feel very satisfied with this relationship.
Uganda has given a safe haven, an attractive investment climate for Chinese-based companies, and we continue to support many more to set up. So we've really enjoyed our partnership with the private sector out of China, but also with the government of the People's Republic of China. And as a ministry, we are delighted to continue this partnership into the future as we work on our different projects.
As a way to mitigate the dangers of climate change resulting from human activities like deforestation for charcoal and other energy supplies, the government is working on a policy that will see all Ugandans stop using firewood and charcoal. This comes in at a time when the country is set to produce its own gas. Uganda uses 22,500 metric tons of gas every year, but the refinery plans to produce 325,000 metric tons of gas, besides many other direct products like petrol and jet fuel.